بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسوله محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. So brothers and sisters, we continue with chapter 79 of Riyad al-Salihin. And in the previous chapter, we discussed in relation to leadership qualities and how one should always be just and kind and generous to the subordinates. We also talked about leadership. Everyone has some sort of leadership and position, and we will all be questioned about our leadership or our subordinates. So it's a responsibility that should be taken seriously, and at the same time, one should try their utmost to fulfill that responsibility to the best of their ability. Here in this chapter 79, the emphasis here is on the leader for justice. So this is why Imam Nawawi begins this chapter by saying Babul Wali Al Adil, that this is the chapter regarding the just or fair ruler. So as usual, Imam Nawawi lists a few verses. So here he has listed two verses of the Quran. Number one from Surah Al-Nahl, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Inna Allaha ya'muru bil adli wal ihsan. And this is a verse that we also covered in the last session. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that it is incumbent to always be just, wal ihsan, and do things with the best of ability, meaning to the best of our perfection, excellence. And the other verse that is mentioned here is the verses of Surah Al-Hujurat, emphasizing justice, adl. Allah says, wa aqsitu inna Allaha yuhibbul muqsitin. Be just. So it's an imperative command. Allah is commanding and summoning us, the reciters of the Quran. وَأَقْسِطُ, be just, be fair. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُقْسِطِينَ. Most certainly Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves those who are fair. Now if we look at the context of this particular verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is speaking about human interaction. And this is one of the surahs of the Quran that many sahaba, many companions, many tabi'un, many great scholars have said, that every believer should understand the implications and the injunctions that are mentioned in this particular surah, in this particular chapter, Surah Al-Hujurat. So why is this? Because Allah is speaking about the human being and the way we should interact with other human beings, with other individuals, whether they be our own families or relatives or people that we engage in business transactions with, or in general, any human being, neighbors, non-Muslims, etc. Allah explains in these verses of Surah Al-Hujurat how our interaction should be. Social etiquettes. Social etiquettes. So, if we take this one verse of the surah, Allah is giving us the understanding of always being fair. وَأَقْسِطُ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُقْسِطِينَ. Allah loves those who are just. So it's an imperative command, and there are various types of commands. And this command is what we call a necessary command. It brings about an injunction. It brings about a command. There are many commands that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, they give as a recommendation. Istihbab. Many commands are for wujub, to make it necessary, to make it incumbent. So here it's incumbent that we always deal fairly and justly with other human beings. And here particularly because Imam Nawawi is speaking about leaders, people who are in positions of leadership, the reference is being made for those leaders. So there are four narrations. We'll recite these four narrations and inshallah conclude. The first narration is on the strength of Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu. He reports from the Messenger, peace and blessings upon him, Sab'atun, there are seven people. يُظِلُّهُمُ اللَّهُ فِي ظِلِّهِ يَوْمَ لَا ظِلَّ إِلَّا ظِلُّهُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will shade all these seven people with his shade on the day when there is no shade except his shade. So on the day of judgment, we know according to one narration that the sun will be very close in proximity. The scholars debate as to what is meant by the word mil. Some say it means a kilometer or a mile's distance. Others say it actually refers to a needle. So the distance of a needle, that's how close the sun will be to us. And people will be in their perspiration, they'll be in their sweat, drowning. Some to their knees, some to their ankles, some to their chest. different in accordance to a person's disobedience or transgression. So that day will be a very severe day. But the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, is telling us that there are seven categories of people who on that day, when the sun is so close in proximity, they will be under the shade of the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يَوْمَ لَا ظِلَّ إِلَّا ظِلُّ. And there's going to be no other shade on that day. It's only Allah's shade. Now who are these seven categories of people? The very first one is connected to the theme of this chapter. إِمَامٌ عَادِلٌ. The leader who is just. The leader who is fair. And then the narration continues, وَشَابٌ نَشَأَ فِي عِبَادَةِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى. A young person, a youthful individual, who spent most of his youth in servitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, recognizing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's injunctions and limits. And despite distractions, we know that youth is a time when the youngsters feel they're invincible and no one can tell them what to do. They can do what they want. And it's a period of time where passions and desires are at their peak, and a person feels that they're invincible, no one can come in their way. So when a person in this state realizes that I have rights that belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I need to recognize these rights, I need to fulfill them, then this is what we call نَشَأَ فِي عِبَادَةِ اللَّهِ. This youngster spent his youth also in servitude of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَرَجُلٌ قَلْبُهُ مُعَلَّقٌ فِي الْمَسَاجِدِ. A man whose heart is constantly attached with the houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we know this refers to that a person is connected to the masjid, meaning that a person is connected with the prayers. A person is connected to the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A person has to get out of the masjid, right, to serve their families, to earn a living, to fulfill obligations and commitments. But at the back of the mind, a person is always aware of obligations related to prayer, obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, etc. وَرَجُلَانِ تَحَابَّا فِي اللَّهِ اِجْتَمَعَ عَلَيْهِ وَتَفَرَّقَ عَلَيْهِ. The Messenger ﷺ says, another category of these blessed people who will be in the shade of the throne of Allah on the Day of Judgment are two people who love each other for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Their gathering is for Allah's sake, and their dispersing from each other is also for Allah's sake. So they meet each other for a good cause, to please Allah. So their teamwork, their collaboration is for the sake of Allah. It's for a good cause, it's for a good purpose. And when they're separated from each other, it's also to fulfill a command of Allah. It's also to be aware of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has instructed. So these two individuals will also be under the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, shade on the Day of Judgment. Another individual, رَجُلٌ دَعَتْهُ إِمْرَأَةٌ ذَاتُ مَنْصَبٍ وَجَمَالٍ فَقَالَ إِنِّي أَخَافُ اللَّهِ. A man who is invited by a beautiful woman who has status and beauty. She invites this man to commit a sin. But this person withdraws and says, إِنِّي أَخَافُ اللَّهِ. I fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A person who guards their modesty and their morality. وَرَجُلٌ تَصَدَّقَ بِصَدَقَةٍ فَأَخَافَهَا حَتَّى لَا تَعْلَمُ شِمَالُهُ مَا تُنْفِقُ يَمِينُهُ. Another individual under the blessed shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the Day of Judgment is a man who gave charity in such a way that they concealed their charity to the extent لَا تَعْلَمُ شِمَالُهُ, that his left hand doesn't know what his right hand spent. Meaning they are generous for the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they empty their wallets, they empty their pockets, and sometimes they don't even count. And we know the famous narration of Aisha radiallahu anha. The Prophet ﷺ asked her, what remains of the meat? And she responded by saying, there's this little portion. So the Prophet ﷺ said, it's the other way around. Right? What we have with us is not what is remains. What we have already given to others, that is what remains. It's perpetual. It'll bring us rewards and blessings, and it'll give us bounties also in paradise. So that is what really remains. Right? So the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, says this is another man who openly gives charity and is generous for the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then finally, رَجُلٌ ذَكَرَ اللَّهَ خَالِيًا فَفَاضَتْ عَيْنَاهُ. An individual who remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in solitude. خَالِيًا, in solitude, alone. ففاضت عينا, and they begin weeping in the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now we see these great categories, and one of my teachers would always say that the Prophet ﷺ mentioned here seven categories of people. So if we can't fit ourselves in every single one of these categories, at least we should try to fit ourselves in one of the categories, so that we could be blessed with the shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on that day, which is a very severe day. يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that's the day where no children will be of avail or help. No wealth will be there to release one from the punishment and severity of the Day of Judgment. Right? So, obviously the reason why this specific narration is listed here by Imam Nawawi is the first category is Imamun Adil, a leader who is just. So, the scholars say that when a person is in leadership, it's a very difficult position. One is because there's a huge trust. And another thing is when a person is in authority, they have certain powers. And if they don't use those powers appropriately, they could end up abusing those powers. And this is why I mentioned in the previous session, I believe, that whenever we look at the Salafus Salihin, we look at the pious predecessors, whenever they were asked to take up a leadership position, they always declined. They always declined. Why? Because they felt that if we take up this leadership position, then this trust will come upon our shoulders, and if we even let go of one individual's right, or we are not considerate about one person's right, then that will haunt us on the day of resurrection. Right? So it's not simply about a position or an authority, it's all about the trust and fulfilling that trust. Right? So part of leadership is to be just, to be fair, and to deal with matters in the most appropriate way. The next narration on the strength of Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As radiyallahu anhuma, he mentions that he heard the Messenger, peace and blessings upon him, say, إِنَّ الْمُقْسِطِينَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ عَلَى مَنَابِرَ مِنْ نُورِ الَّذِينَ يَعْدِلُونَ فِي حُكْمِهِمْ وَأَهْلِيهِمْ وَمَا وُلُّوا. Certainly those people who are just, meaning their trait is they always behave with justice, with fairness, these people on the Day of Judgment by Allah will be on pulpits of light. Manabira min nur. They will be on pulpits, positions, on pedestals that are of divine light, nur. And what does the Messenger ﷺ say? Alladina. These are those people, ya'diluna fi hukmihim. They always make judgments that are just. Whenever they make a decision regarding their personal matters, family matters, community matters, individual matters, business affairs, whatever it may be, they make a decision that is fair, that is just. وَأَهْلِيهِمْ, and also in relation to their family. وَمَا وُلُّوا, and any matter which they have been trusted with. So once we have been given a trust, and there is a decision that needs to be made, we should be very careful about making the right decision. And if we make the right decision, then we will be on this pedestal on the Day of Judgment. May Allah make us amongst them. Say Ameen. So these are rewards that the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, speaks about. Now the ulama, they explain that when something is very challenging, when something is very difficult to do, if someone completes that and achieves that, the rewards are tremendous. And this is why the ulama say that if we look at this narration, the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, didn't say, إِنَّ الْمُخْسِطِينَ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ عَلَى مَنَابِرَ مِنْ نُورِ. The Prophet ﷺ didn't say that those who are just will be on the Day of Judgment on pulpits of light. The Prophet ﷺ used the words, إِنْدَ اللَّهِ. That means, with Allah. إِنْد means to be with or near. So, by Allah, meaning in accordance to the judgment of Allah, that's also in this world, and that's also in the hereafter. They are under the divine light of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are with Allah's protection. They are with Allah's inspiration. They are with the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, and then we see the three categories that are mentioned here. One is specifically hukm. Hukm means any judgment. So when a person is called, the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, says in one narration, when an individual is called to make a judgment between even two people, then فَقَدْ ذُبِحَ بِالسِّكِّينَ. It's as if this person has been slaughtered by a knife. Why? Because if they've made the wrong decision, then there's going to be sin. There's going to be anger. There's going to be wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if they've made the right decision and they're arrogant about it, that's also dangerous. Because a person in position and authority, if they get arrogant, then all the good they do, it's worthless. The Prophet ﷺ speaks about three people who have achieved tremendous good in terms of being so generous, in terms of having so much knowledge, and in terms of a person giving even his life. But the lack of sincerity will result these individuals to begin the punishment of the hellfire. May Allah protect every one of us. So these are positions of authority that are very dangerous. There's a lot of trust. And if we're not just, if we're not careful, if we don't fulfill the trust properly, then instead of getting blessings, we will be punished. And on the reverse, if we are just, if we do deal appropriately, then we will be rewarded tremendously. And this is why the word indallah is being used here. The next narration is on the strength of Aws ibn Malik. He says here that he heard the Messenger, peace and blessings upon him, say, خِيَارُ أَئِمَّتِكُمْ أَلَّذِينَ تُحِبُّونَهُمْ وَيُحِبُّونَكُمْ وَتُصَلُّونَ عَلَيْهِمْ وَيُصَلُّونَ عَلَيْكُمْ وَشِرَارُ أَئِمَّتِكُمْ أَلَّذِينَ تُبْغِضُونَهُمْ وَيُبْغِضُونَكُمْ وَتَلْعَنُونَهُمْ وَيَلْعَنُونَكُمْ. Subhanallah. The Messenger ﷺ says, the best of your leaders are those whom you love and they also love you. Meaning there's a mutual understanding. There's mutual understanding. And the subordinates will love their leaders if their leaders are making the appropriate decisions. If their leaders are being careful about the needs and the requirements of their subordinates. And vice versa as well. So the best of leaders are those whom you love and they also love you. وَتُصَلُّونَ عَلَيْهِمْ وَيُصَلُّونَ عَلَيْكُمْ. You pray for them and they pray for you. You pray for them and they pray for you. وَشِرَارُ أَئِمَّتِكُمْ. And the most evil of leaders amongst you are those whom you hate and they also hate you. You hate and they also hate you. وَتَلْعَنُونَهُمْ وَيَلْعَنُونَكُمْ. You curse them and they curse you. Meaning there's no cooperation, there's no understanding, there's no collaboration. Rather, it's a tense relationship. And we see in different parts of the world how there's challenging situations, there are difficult situations, and it's because of few leaders who are making the wrong decisions, they're not getting off to their positions, they're not doing a great job themselves, and nor do they want to hand over the leadership to someone who's more appropriate. So it's causing chaos. It causes so much injustice, it causes so much loss of life. It's a tremendous chaos. So the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, is giving us the two categories of people. Now the Sahaba, they asked very appropriate questions. When they heard this, that there's two kinds of leaders. Those that are good, where there's collaboration, there's prayer for each other, there's commitment to each other. And the worst of leaders are those where there's no collaboration, where there's no cooperation. So the Sahaba asked the question, قُلْنَا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, O Messenger of Allah, أَفَلَا نُنَابِذُهُمْ. If we ever come across leaders that are unjust and we dislike them, should we just forego our allegiance from them? Should we just forsake our allegiance? Meaning we disobey them, we disregard them. So the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, said, La. He said, no, don't do this. He said, مَقَامُ فِيكُمْ الصَّلَاةِ مَقَامُ فِيكُمْ الصَّلَاةِ. He says, as long as they are establishing the prayer, then obey their orders. As long as they are establishing the prayer, then obey their orders. Now, there's a lot of discussions amongst the ulama that what is the Prophet ﷺ referring to here. But in general, what is being referred to here is that if they have not done a fragrant disobedience, it's something that is very open, something that is very awkward in terms of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the tenets. So they still believe in Allah, they still establish the prayer, meaning they are punctual with what Allah has commanded. Then some of their decisions may not be appropriate, but we still need to follow their leadership. However, if there's something that is openly an injustice, it's something that is disregarded in terms of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then in that case, we can go against that leadership. We can go against that leadership. Now obviously what the Prophet ﷺ is referring to here is khilafah. He's referring to an Islamic state. He's referring to where there's the caliph for the Muslims who is selected by the Muslim community. Okay. However, when the Islamic State is not there, then many of these rules and many of these regulations that we see, both in the Quran and the teachings of the Prophet ﷺ, when the context is not there, then many of these things cannot be undertaken. We cannot be vigilantes. So, the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, is telling the ummah that maintain the unity, as long as a person is adhering to the maintenance of Islam. Right? The other day someone asked me, you know, there's a person who doesn't have a beard, should I perform salah behind him? Doesn't wear a cap, right? A couple of months ago, one of the imams was absent, so they had a young hafiz who was leading the salah, and he was trimming his beard. So someone said, you know, I don't feel like praying behind him. He doesn't have a full beard, right? So I'm telling him that he's the appointed imam. He's the appointed imam, so we pray behind him. If you have doubt in your salah, you can repeat it individually. Don't cause a commotion, don't cause chaos. Right? So this is what the Prophet ﷺ is telling us. مَا أَقَامُ الصَّلَاةِ As long as they establish the prayer, their apparent action is Islamic. And they have been appointed for a position, then follow their leadership. Yes, if there's something where the person says, I deny the Qur'an, now it's a question to say, how can I pray behind him? He doesn't believe in the Qur'an. But when there's little aspects that are not of halal and haram, it's not about permissible and impermissible, it's not about iman and kufr, it's minor things. Yes, it's a sunnah, it's a emphasized sunnah to have a beard and a certain length, etc. But it's not something that takes one out of the fold of Islam. So this should not be a means of disunity and discord. This should rather be an opportunity to recognize that there are differences. There are minor differences in our teachings and the way the Prophet ﷺ encouraged certain things. And these are acceptable differences. They don't take a person out of the fold of Islam. So this is what exactly the Messenger ﷺ is referring to here, is that as long as the leader is suitable in terms of their aqidah, their beliefs and their tenets, and there's no open disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then continue following their leadership. So the Prophet ﷺ is emphasizing unity as well here. Now, the last narration here is on the strength of Iyad ibn Himar radiallahu anhu. He says, سَمِعْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ وَسَلَّمَ يَقُولُ I heard the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم speaking about paradise. أَهْلُ الْجَنَّةِ ثَلَاثٌ And at this particular occasion, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم mentioned that there are three people that are guaranteed paradise. أَهْلُ الْجَنَّةِ ثَلَاثَةٌ There are three categories of people who are guaranteed paradise. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم listed them. Number one, ذُو سُلْطَانٍ مُقْسِطٍ مُوَفِّقٍ A leader who is just and is successful. A leader who is just, muwaffiq means he has been given the tawfiq, he has been given the divine understanding to deal appropriately with the community, with the subordinates. So a leader who is fair, and Allah has blessed him with an appropriate understanding to deal with the matters, this person is guaranteed paradise, the Prophet ﷺ says. Meaning this person is aware of the situation of the people, understands the limitations and the difficulties, and addresses them appropriately. Doesn't go to extremes. Addresses the issue, addresses the matter, and solves the majority of the issues that are in the community. So this is a person that will be promised paradise on the tongue of the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him. Another individual. رَجُلٌ رَحِيمٌ رَقِيقُ الْقَلْبِ لِكُلِّ ذِي قُرْبَى A man who is very merciful, who's very kind at heart to every relative. The importance of maintaining relations with kith and kin, with close relatives, extended relatives. So a person will definitely see irritations. You know, brother-in-law said this, oh, I don't want to speak to him anymore. Or that sister, oh, she didn't invite me for that party, I don't want to know her now. You hear these kind of sentiments, you hear these kind of things, you know. Oh, my parents, they got really angry at me, so I don't want to speak to them, I don't want to know them, I'm going to leave the house. Okay, you have these kind of situations. So, the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, is giving this indication that despite these challenges, despite these difficulties, a person is kind and tries to address the matter with goodness, with kindness. Then in that case, because of this tremendous sacrifice, that even though there's irritations and difficulties, a person is kind, is generous, is lenient, In these situations, the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, is promising paradise. رَجُلٌ رَحِيمٌ رَقِيقُ الْقَلْبِ I'm giving you the literal translation. A man who is merciful, رَقِيقُ الْقَلْبِ He's kind at heart, لِكُلِّ ذِي قُرْبَى For every individual who's his kith and kin, who's his relative. And number three, وَمُسْلِمٌ عَفِيفٌ مُتَعَفِّفٌ ذُو عِيَالٍ The Muslim who is modest and is self-sufficient, ذُو عِيَال, and has family. A Muslim who is modest. عَفِيف means they're pure at heart. They're modest, they're morally upright, they have good character, good morals. مُتَعَفِّف means they're self-sufficient, meaning that they don't beg people for their needs. They try to fulfill their own needs themselves. If there's a need, they ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They don't beg others for their needs. They fulfill their needs on their own. And then ذُو عِيَالٍ And they're a person of family. Meaning that they have a family, they have children, they have spouse, and they are able to maintain the relationship with this family. Then these are great achievements in this individual's life. So the Prophet ﷺ is promising paradise. These are three categories of people whom the Prophet ﷺ promises paradise for. So we should strive to always be just. And the individual the Prophet ﷺ is talking about maintaining relationships and being good Muslims with good qualities of purity, character, and good relations with family. So we make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us these tremendous qualities of leadership. May Allah give us kindness in our hearts and good character. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remove the sufferings of all those who suffer. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulihi muhammadi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. اللهم ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. اللهم وفقنا لما تحب وترضى من القول والعمل والنية والهدي والهدى. إنك على كل شيء قدير. اللهم ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم. وتب علينا مولانا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. وصلى الله تعالى على خير خلقه محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين.